Sorry, I got a call from Maths HOD. That's why I had to attend it. Okay, so basically I'm just showing you what this means. So this is effectively held in position at both ends, but it's restrained against rotation only at one end. Okay, meaning that it's this one is not, this is not one end roller, this is one end hinge. So this is basically a column which has this kind of sub conditions. Okay, and for this they say you can use effective length theoretical factors 0.7, recommended values 0.8, and the next one is effectively held in position at both ends but not restrained against rotation at either of the ends. Okay, so what do you think this is? The effective length factor is 1. What type of support conditions do you think this is?
Simply supported.
It's simply supported. So that is simply supported. It's identified. Next one also says effectively held in position and restrained against rotation at one end. And in the other end, it is restrained against rotation, but it is not held in position. Okay, meaning that one end is fixed and the other end is. What does this look like? The top end. It's moving alone. It's not rotating. What kind of a support do you think this is? Okay, you may not have come across it. It's basically something like this. Basically, you have a roller which allows movement only along the horizontal direction. Okay, allows movement only along the horizontal direction. So if you have a column like this, then these are the effective length factors. Okay, and the same thing with hinge at the bottom. Okay, so basically this type of a column. Okay, a roller goes this way. So you have the effective length factor for that as well, and then finally you have effectively held in position and restrained against rotation at one end, but not held in position, nor restrained against rotation at the other end. What kind of a column is this? The last one.
Just fixed column.
Yeah, it's like a cantilever used as a column. Okay, that's it. Okay, so here you, one thing that you notice is always you see that which value of effective length is greater, theoretical or recommended. So you see that usually the recommended value is the code recommends a greater value of effective length as compared to the theoretical value which you use in Euler's formula. The reason being, so when I say it's a fixed column like this, okay, it may not always be perfectly fixed. Okay, it may not be perfect. There may be a bit of rotation. Okay, there may be a bit of rotation happening. Okay, it's not. When I say that I had a column, I connected with the slab and the surrounding columns and whatever way I fixed. Even if I fixed it to the foundation at the bottom, I cannot say that it has infinite fixity. Okay, it has some, may have a bit of flexibility in that support. Okay, or rotation in that support. So therefore, to account for that little bit of non-idealness, the code recommends slightly increased values of effective length. What you will notice is you will have a different effective length and a different theoretical length only when you have fixed supports. So if you look at these pictures, this is fixed, and you see that effective recommended value has increased. Here also you have a fixed support, so this has increased. Look at this. This is a simply supported column. Both are, when I say a simply supported or a pin support, that means there is zero restraint against rotation. Okay. Absolute zero restraint against rotation. That is the meaning of a pin support. So therefore, here theoretical and recommended values are same. It does not recommend any increase in the effective length factor because anyway this is already a pin. There is no stiffness to lose beyond this. Okay. So you see that only when you have fixedness, you will have changes in the thing. Okay. And here this one, you have a one end. So here one question is, here you have a fixed support, but still they have not increased the recommended effect length factor. Whatever is the theoretical, they recommended that itself as the recommended value, even though you have fixed support at the bottom. So why have they made this relaxation only for this case? Any idea? Instead of increasing the effect length factor further, why is there a relaxation made here that they'll use the same recommended value as the theoretical, while everywhere else they have increased it when you have a fixed support? Any idea why that relaxation was made? Any guesses? Okay, it's very simple. It's just a manual reasoning. So basically, when you have this case, the theoretical value is 2 for effective length factor. So pi square ei by 2l square will become 4l square. Or this is about 1/4 the PCR of a simply supported beam. Okay. So you already have 1/4 reduction in the critical load. So they say this is already a bit low. So they do not want to increase it, decrease it any further. Do not. So they basically mean that this is already conservative. They feel, the code writers felt that this is already quite conservative because it's 1/4 the critical load of a simply supported beam. Okay, so there's no real necessity to even reduce the critical load further for design purpose. So that's why for this alone they have retained it as 2 itself, the effective length factor. Okay, that's the reason for actually doing this. Okay, so this is effective length factor. Now coming back to slender columns, now how these things behave. Okay, so basically you need to know how a slender column will function under the given load. Okay, so basically if we have a column like this, so I'll give a column, I'll use simply supported case itself because that is the easiest to explain with. They have a load P, okay, which acts through the centroid itself. Let me assume it acts through the centroid. Okay. Now, if it's a slender column, you know that you have already, according to this Euler buckling theory, any slender column will undergo a bit of buckling. Okay. So, let me say that it buckles in a certain manner. It buckles to take up this shape. It buckles and takes up a shape like this. So therefore, I have a bit of, if I take the middle point, I have a bit of lateral deflection introduced because of this buckling. So this, let's say I call this as a certain value eccentricity E. Now, under this combination of loading, if I take this point over here, okay, so this load P, I have no doubt this load P has, this axial load has to go through the column. So this axial load will obviously flow through the centroid, and that's how it can actually go to the next support. So you have at this point E, at this particular point, you have your axial load which is equal to P. In addition, you will also have something else at this particular cross section. Okay, you'll have something else at this particular cross section. Do you know what you have in addition to axial load at this point? Other than axial load, you'll also have something else.
Oh, flash path. What free island?
Okay. You can't go. So what do you have in addition to axial load?
Bending moment.
Yeah, do you know how much that bending moment will be? based on the things that I've shown here, do you have any idea how much that bending moment is going to be?
P
into the common term we use is actually not E. You can get confused with eccentricity, and we call it as, in fact, it has a name, so I'll call this as P. Should be small delta. This is the common notation. So you have a moment equal to P times small delta. Okay. So now what happens, because you have applied the axial load, there is a lateral deflection delta, and that causes a moment P times delta. Now what happens is, this becomes a case where you, at this particular section, you start having this extra moment of P times delta. Okay. And what happens is, this P delta, this moment which you have, which is present at this particular cross section, will further cause more curvature to the column. Okay. So this ends up further increasing it further increases the deflection, and this further increases the moment. Okay, so like you see, you have a cycle where there's a drive between the given axial load, which causes the deflection, and the moment which is caused, which further amplifies, the actual load is amplified, which further amplifies the lateral deflection. So this effect, by which you have extra moments caused by the deflection and its effect on the lateral deflection, this is, has in fact the same name, it's known as P delta effect. Okay, so this is something which is typical to slender columns. So whenever you take the moment that is probably cast across this beam, you may have say this is your, so this is delta. Let's assume that there is some eccentricity also times E. Okay, if at all there is an eccentricity, if it's not there, then no problem. So I have, I'm drawing a BMD. Okay. So if at all this load is acting at a, if at all this load is acting at an eccentricity given by E, then throughout this column I have a bending moment equal to P times E. Okay, throughout the height of the column. In addition, if it's because of the slenderness of the column and this delta effect, P delta effect, and all those things, I see that at this point I have a bending moment equal to P times delta. Okay, so this is at the middle of the column. How about at the ends of the column? How much is the moment at the ends of the column? Will it be the same P times delta, or will it be something else, the bending moment at this point caused by the buckling?
Zero, zero.
There will be zero here, because there's no lateral deflection at the supports. So therefore, your extra bending moment will be, it will be resembling the deflected shape itself. Okay. So your total bending moment in that case will be P times delta plus P times E. If you do not have eccentricity, it will be just P times delta. Okay. But in general, this bending moment across this picture is given by M equals P into, especially at this point, you have E plus whatever is the delta at that particular point. Okay. So this P times E and P times delta. Okay. So this is known as your primary moment, and this is known as your P delta moment. This primary moment may include applied moments also, in case there is an externally applied moment. So for example, instead of having just P, if I also have externally applied a moment, that will also be included in primary moment. Okay, so this is how it is. And only thing is, actually determining this P delta effect, it's once again, it's an iterative process. So you have to first know the stiffness of the beam. You need to assume a certain deflected shape, then find out. So you need to, in the actual processes, you'll be assuming a deflected shape. And once you assume the deflected shape, then from this assumed deflected shape, you will calculate what the P delta effect, moments, etc. are. Okay, and then you will check whether whether the deflection that you assumed from this P delta moment. So you have your EA value, your stiffness value, and all those things. So using your principles, you'll be actually calculating the actual deflections. Okay, and once you calculate the actual deflections, you will compare that with what you assumed. If they converge, then you'll say, yeah, this is the right moment. If they do not converge, then you'll say that you'll have to iterate again. And you'll have to get a converged solution for the deflected shape. And once only you get that, only you can find out the actual moments which you need to design for. That's a bit of a difficult process. Okay, so therefore, your code book gives you an alternative. Okay. It code book gives you an alternative. So that alternative only is given what I showed in the code book, no, sometime back. Okay, where is it? So basically, it gives you these formulae. It gives you these for that. That's the additional moments. So that is what is actually mentioned over here. The design of slender compression members shall be based on the forces and the moments determined from an analysis of the structure, including the effects of deflection on the moments. Okay. So this is the effect of deflection on the moments. Okay, this is the deflection of effect of deflections on the moments. So it says you have to actually do this and then find the moments and the other things before you design. But if you say that that's a bit difficult to do, then you can try, decide to probably not take the effect of the deflection into account. And when you decide that way, you can use this formula to find out the additional moments. Okay, so this is what is actually the process for the code book based process for defining a cylinder column. So as far as comparison and behavior between cylinder and short column, so if you have a short column, okay, so if you have a short column, whatever be the boundary conditions, okay, so this, as I told you, it will, I think when in the initial paper itself, I showed you some comparisons between cylinder and short columns. So in a short column, basically you're going to have, you know, cracking happening and maybe a bit of, you know, some bulging also. Okay. However, if you have a long or a slender column, we have this. Okay. So we have this, you know, what I showed here, we have buckling and all those things happening. Okay, so this is actually crushing, or it's called a squash failure. This is buckling. Okay, so this is the typical differences between both the type of columns. And buckling itself, it's you are only used to seeing one single half wave. So this is another thing that I have not told you till now. So if this is simply support column, so once you have something like this, then you know that this column is going to buckle like this, and corresponding to this, you have Okay, so this is something that you are, this is something that you are a bit familiar with. Okay, but this is not the only curve that I can draw. Okay, I can also draw a curve like this. Okay, I can also have a buckling mode. It's called a buckling mode. Okay, I can also have a buckling mode like this. Any idea what PCR is in this case? For those who remember Euler's buckling theory, any guesses what would be the buckling load for this case?
So 4x.
Yeah, good. How did you find that out?
Like I took that. Crossing.
Good. Yeah. Excellent. So basically, it's almost as if the effective length has reduced to half. Okay. So what he says is, he has taken L to be L by 2, okay, and therefore he said it will be 4 times. So if this becomes L by 2, then 4 will go up. So 4 pi square EI by L square, or in general for any nth mode of buckling, okay, if I'm just sticking with simply some columns alone, in fact, I say PCR N equals N square pi square EI by L square. So similarly, you can have 3 waves, 4 waves, 5 waves, any number of waves that you can have. Only thing is, practically speaking, in many of the cases, other than the first mode, which is known as the fundamental, okay, other than the fundamental mode, mostly the remaining modes will not be of much practical use at all in finding. Okay, for example, in a design point of view, you know that if you have a column, when you reach pi square AB L square, the column is going to buckle. Okay, and nobody is going to continue to load the column further till they reach 4 pi square AB L square. Okay, so for third mode, it becomes nine pi square AB L square, then 16 pi square AB L square, like that. That's how it goes. So in buckling problems, for certain studies these are useful, okay, but from design point of view, mostly unless somebody specifies in the question that the column, sometimes may be specified that column is restrained to undergo anti-symmetric or symmetric buckling, meaning that it's going to have a buckling like this, unless it is specified that by some measure, like probably a spring or something which is attached over here, unless something is provided to force the column to go into this buckling mode, otherwise you will not in practically be able to achieve this kind of buckling modes. Okay, but these are things that you should know, and you should also know how different buckling modes look. For example, for a fixed beam, okay, you will not have a buckling mode like this, okay, because there can be no rotation at this point. So in fact, your buckling curve will be something like this. And so any guesses what this length of buckling is? You can have a look at your Annex E. What do you think that length is between the two points of buckling?
L by 2.
So theoretically speaking, it is L by 2. So basically, this tells you what effective length factor means. Okay, basically, effective length factor means it basically tells you within which part of the column is the buckling actually taking place. Okay, that length is specified as effective length, and in order to know how much it is, they are given the factor. Okay, so it's very simple. That is the basically the purpose behind all of this. Okay, so the process of designing this listed down. Process of designing the solution column. Okay, so I just have a example here. I'm just listing down the steps what is used so that you can probably have a look at it later. Okay. So the first step is obviously the slenderness ratio check. So we need to know if it's a slender column at all. If it's not a slender, if it's coming less than 2, then you don't need to do any of this. You can use the normal equation itself. Okay. So you'll be greater than 12. Okay. So it's greater than 10, then you go with it. Then minimum eccentricity check as usual. Okay, so basically the you'll find EX and EX minimum, EY minimum. Then you'll compare it with 0.05D and 0.05B, D, all these things. And if it's a, so if it's a, actually it doesn't matter in this case because anyway you're going to design for the moment. So even if it doesn't satisfy this, you're still going to be designing for a moment, so it doesn't matter. Okay. And then you will have to find out existing loads and moments. Okay. Whatever is given in the question. Okay. So those things you may have to find out. And then you will be converting this into eccentricities. Okay. So basically you'll be getting EX equals whatever MX you have got from whatever is given to you as MX, that divided by whatever axial load is given in the column is EX corresponding to this moments. So EY will be MY by P. Okay. So you will also basically be checking this with your minimum eccentricities. So this check, no, the same minimum eccentricity check. So you will also be checking whether these correspond to the same the type of a case. Okay. So now what you do is you basically compare these with so what it needs to do is you will see whether which of this is more. Okay, if the eccentricity is coming from your moments, okay, the eccentricities which you calculate from your moment, if they are more, then you can continue with designing for these moments. Okay, if these are more, then what you have to do is you have to use these eccentricities and you will have to say the actual moment which you design for should be equal to P times what you had over here. So I'll just repeat it. So you'll be calculating eccentricity out of the moments and loads. You compare them with whatever minimum you had calculated. And in case whatever the eccentricities coming from the moments are eccentricities calculated from the moments, if they are more, then you can continue to use MX and MY itself as your primary moment. Okay. But however, in case the minimum eccentricities are found to be more than what you calculate from the moments, then you have to calculate your primary moment based on the minimum eccentricities. Okay, so based on this, we'll have to choose which is the moment that you're going to use. Okay, then the next step is you will be doing the additional eccentricities and moments. Okay, so there are two parts to this. This is why I said, this is why I drew this picture over here. So this part is what you have found now. Okay, primary moment. Okay, so this is the part that you have found from this step number 3. Step number 4, you'll have to calculate how much moment is caused by these, the maximum moment is caused by this effect, the P delta effect. But we do not want to do this tedious procedure. We do not want to do this. So therefore, you use the caudal procedure, which gives you a direct formula. And let me just probably write it on the code book itself for your convenience. PUD ADX no, I like that. Okay, PUD by 2000. So PUD so PUD by 2000 into LEX by D square and similarly M AY equals the same thing, instead of D you have B. And these ratios of LEX by D and LE by BB, so depending on what direction you fix for D and B, that depends. Sometimes you may think that X direction is shorter and Y direction is bigger. In that case, this will be interchanged. This will become B and this will become D. Okay. So that things you have just have to, according to your question, you have to decide what that is. Okay. And then that's about it. Then you just follow the procedure as you did for biaxial bending. Okay, so your total moments will be, so total moments will be M, let me say M PX for primary, M PX, M PY. Okay, so M X equals M primary plus M AX, M Y equals M primary Y plus additional Y, and of course you also have your PU. Okay, so based on all this, design as a column with biaxial bending. Okay, so that's it. So biaxial bending, you know what to do, and so you can just adopt the same procedure and you can do the design. Okay, so I'll give a problem later based on this for you to do.